kids choose their idols for the electric age. They're better known than Jesus. They admit it, and they love their role. Lyndon Johnson's role has been thrust upon him. He must pull together a nation searching for leadership.
We have suffered a loss that cannot be weighed. For me, it is a deep personal tragedy. I know that the world shares the sorrow that Mrs. Kennedy and her family bear. I will do my best. That is all I can do. I ask for your help and God's.
It seems the mismatch of the year. Carol Channing is a Jewish matchmaker from the Bronx. But on Broadway, everybody loves Dolly. Back in 1776, England lost her American colonies in bloody revolution. Now in 64, John, Paul, George, and Ringo fly in to take them back. And all the screamers get to the airport to plead, please, please, me.
Can we please have quiet?
If some of the press is insulting, the money isn't. They'll make a million in 33 days. Someone will even make $150,000 cutting up their bedsheets.
Will you please shut up?
Listen, I got a question you're referring to.
Do you want to get a haircut at all?
No.
No.
I had one yesterday.
What are you making face over?
It's one of it, eh?
Great.
Especially his poems.
The British invasion this time goes by the code name Beatlemania. D-Day has been common knowledge for months, and this was the day. Invasion took place in New York's Kennedy International Airport.
Fans tear up the rugs they walk on, too. The only safe place is a locked hotel room.
I'm going to get a haircut at all?
No.
I had one yesterday. No.
The Beatles come to play Carnegie Hall. The kids let go. And a 15-year-old says, you scream so they'll notice you. Oh, I'm going to die. John says, oh, don't do that look. Ringo says, fantastic, they all seem out of their minds. Have a field day trying to explain the hysteria. Even yeah goes down on the analyst couch. No one does it quite like Marshall McLuhan.
One of the things about the Beatle music, for example, that is so effective is that they were the first, as far as I know, to put English popular speech, popular lower class British Cockney rhythms and Liverpool rhythms into musical form. The English have never had a music directly related to popular speech before. When you make a music that is related to popular speech, it enables the singer to put on the whole audience, the public, as a mask and wear it as a mask of power. The Beatles are powerful. Any popular music is powerful because it puts on the rhythms and the patterns of the whole audience as a mask. I come from a 19th century country, Canada, and this gives me a great advantage in looking at the 20th century.
McLuhan surfaces with a book, Understanding Media. He tells advertising agencies, television networks, huge corporations, that a new age has dawned. What seems to be is not what it seems. The electric light, he explains, is pure information. People don't want to read newspapers. They just slip into them in the morning like a hot bath.
One of the strange features of our time is the joke without the storyline. Simply the gag, like the surgeon, the expensive surgeon who, when his patients couldn't afford surgery, would offer to touch up the x-ray for free. Or the Polish jokes like Alexander Graham Kowalski, the first telephone pole. That was the first Polish joke I ever heard. One of the best. It's possible, or the what's electric, what's purple and hums? Why, naturally, an electric grape. Well, why does it hum? Doesn't know the words. And these jokes have no storyline. They're just conundrums, and the kids eat them up. They don't. They think the old storyline jokes are strictly square.
But I was surprised to see all the TV aerials in Moscow. There's a forest of them, almost a million aerials. No sets, just aerials.
I entered the service after I graduated high school because the dropouts already had the jobs.
What did Mr. Adams do before he let you pull out into traffic? Well, I mean, besides praying, let's say. No, what I had in mind was checking the rearview mirror. You see, we always want to check the rear... Don't pull out!
Take it straight up, bring it straight down. Run it all in one piece, right? Okay, Speed? They don't make sense. They're going through all kinds of things.
I don't understand. Either do I. Click that person.
Never mind.
Sometimes McLuhan just likes playing with the message. Along the way, there are some new meanings for some old terms.
Cool is evolving. Hot is not. My friend is fond of explaining that when he came to this part of New York, the cops told him, if you're ever in trouble, never shout help, shout fire. And he said, if you shout fire, all the windows will go up. If you shout help, you'll get nothing. Help is too involving. It demands too much from most people. They're afraid. Fire is not involving. It's a hot medium. The conflict going on in Vietnam has a corresponding conflict within ourselves. We have a hot war being reported on a cool medium, and it creates a great deal of distaste and reluctance in the population at large, which is very difficult for most people to understand. But the TV medium is so involving in the process of whatever's going on that it is cool, and when it handles war and the sufferings of war, it creates an audience involvement which makes war most untakeable. So Vietnam is our first TV war, and people are finding it not too much to their liking. It may be necessary to ban it altogether from TV from now on.
Mao Zedong is 71. 600,000 of the 600 million parade through Peking to wish him many happy returns. He's the undisputed ruler of a quarter of the human race. His little red book out-circulates the Bible, making him the best-read author of all time. Power, says Mao, grows out of the barrel of a gun. But China's power grows out of the labor of her people. No one goes hungry anymore. No one is idle anymore. There are no flies in China. And not many bulldozers either. But the regime builds all the causeways it needs, with a little help from its friends.
This cofferdam is made of rock, and it's over 5 miles long. The technology may be primitive, but the techniques are pretty sound. The schools are full, the curriculums straightforward. Reading, writing, and the thoughts of Chairman Mao. After the proclamation, the People's Republic becomes a nuclear power. On October 16th, the familiar mushroom cloud climbs over the Xinjiang desert. Soon they will have the power to deliver the bomb. 20,000 kilotons plus 600 million Chinese. Who's afraid of the yellow peril? Who isn't? The fallout from China's bomb ends this man's career. Nikita Khrushchev is overthrown. One day, the father of his people, epitome of every Soviet virtue. The next, scapegoat of the nation. That's how the Kremlin crumbles. Khrushchev was the most widely traveled of dictators. He'd been everywhere, met everybody. Most familiar of all has been Khrushchev, the Cold War warrior.
That understanding,
Television viewers get their most intimate glimpse of him in an encounter with David Susskind. It's what you might call a mismatch.
They can only hear what you're saying.
No, no, no.
See how astute you Americans are.
No. Who could not hear you? Your projection's incredible.
Yeah. 1 billion. How old are you?
39.
You are a young man.
I'm aging.
I've got sons that are older. And therefore, I say that you evidently are, you do not have a very good knowledge of history. When the great October Revolution took place, then a military landing party was sent into our country by the United States, Britain, France,
Germany,
and Japan. And they imposed a civil war upon us. The White Guard, the Tsarist generals, were advancing on Tula and
Moscow.
You know that gesture you have?
When that is required, we'll come to that, but it's not required now.
Забрали Сибирь.
They occupied Siberia.
Захватили Украину.
They seized the Ukraine.
Захватили Белоруссию.
They seized Belarus.
Подошли 150 километров от Москвы.
They were within 150 kilometers of Moscow.
Русский народ.
But the Russian people.
Украинский народ.
The Ukrainian people.
Белорусский народ.
The Belarusian people.
Все народы Советского Союза.
And all the peoples of the Soviet Union.
Взяли метлу, мели всех в океан.
Took a broom and swept them all into the ocean.
Today, Nikita Sergeyevich and his wife Nina live quietly off their old age pensions in this modest dacha outside Moscow. A great leap forward in Soviet political development. Its leader can be fired without being shot. It didn't always work that way. People of India mourn the passing of their leader. Jawaharlal Nehru lies on his funeral pyre. For more than 40 years, Nehru fought for the independence of India. First to be free of the British, then to be free of poverty, ignorance, disease. At 75, his life's work is not complete. But no Indian statesman's work will ever be complete. Douglas Hume is Britain's prime minister. He loses an election to Labour's Harold Wilson. Wilson replaces Hume at number 10 Downing Street. And at Madame Tussaud's Wax Museum. Back at the White House, LBJ is enjoying it more. But his beagles are enjoying it less. Dog lovers of America yelp louder than the hounds. The president explains they like being picked up by the ears. After all, that's how he treats politicians, too.
Great honor on behalf of the...
Martin Luther King journeys to Stockholm to receive the Nobel Prize for Peace. The award is worth $53,000. He donates it to the civil rights movement to keep the fires of hope burning.
Diploma and a gold medal.
I accept this award on behalf of the civil rights movement, which is moving with determination and a majestic scorn for risk and danger.
There's lots of risk and danger in the state of Mississippi. The Ku Klux Klan are out again.
The black man got a champion. They call him Martin Luther King. We call him Martin Luther.
All summer, they burn crosses and Negro churches, schoolhouses, homes. This time, there's organized opposition.
I'm gonna let it shine down in Mississippi. I'm gonna let it shine.
These are college students from every corner of the nation. They volunteered for active service to help the black people of Mississippi learn their rights and get their names on a voter's list. On a quiet campus in Ohio, the volunteers train for their freedom summer.
An encouragement to many of these people to do a little bit more dirt. The police are going to harass you. They're going to pick you up on the road. They're going to put chopped up charges on you. You're going to wind up in jail. There's no doubt about it. So you need to know these things just as much as the people who left last week for voter registration. And another thing, I suggest we be a little more serious about this thing. I know it don't even seem real to you now, but it will when you go down to Mississippi.
What you doing on the floor all the time?
It's boot camp for civil rights. Here you learn what it's like to be kicked when you're down.
Hey, go put him to the phone as I can. Get on the floor. Hey, Joe. Get on the floor, Joe. You like to be in it? Get on the floor, Joe. Throw him to the gallery.
He don't look like nothing but a damn.
If you're lucky, that's the worst that will happen to you.
Three civil rights workers who disappeared in Mississippi last Sunday night still have not been heard from. A search has thus far produced only one clue, the burned-out station wagon in which the three were last seen riding. There is little hope that they are still alive.
James Cheney, 23. Michael Schwerner, 24. Andrew Goodman, 20. A massive search begins. FBI agents pour into the state. They learn that the three civil rights workers were arrested in a small town for speeding, kept all day in police cells, then released into the Mississippi night. 400 sailors drag the rivers, and the quiet countryside gives up its secrets. Decomposed bodies are found, but they are not those of Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney. The FBI offers a $25,000 reward, and the conspiracy of silence is broken. Acting on an informer's tip, agents find the bodies under 25 feet of clay. They are brought back to Meridian at night by the same sheriff who escorted them out of town. The two white boys were shot once each through the heart. James Cheney, the black youth, had been beaten with chains until every bone in his body was broken. Then he was shot three times. The local sheriff's charged with murder along with his deputy and 19 others. They all go free.
Now, know what they're going to say? Not guilty? Because no one saw them pull the trigger? I'm tired of that. Don't bow down anymore. Hold your heads up.
At the funeral of James Cheney, a fellow civil rights worker delivers the oration.
We want our freedom now. I don't want to have to go to another memorial. I'm tired of funerals. Tired of it. Got to stand up.
We shall.
And Ben Cheney, 12 years old, sings in his brother's memory. Japan is fast becoming more westernized than the West. A chain of beauty salons opens in Osaka, for men only. Within 2 weeks, they have over 1,000 customers. Japan's finest facial earth is flown in daily from the Kyoto River flats. After this kind of treatment, nobody seems to sing in the bathtub. But back home in Illinois, a mouse turns up with a range of 2 octaves. Mark the Chimp wows the New York art world with a stunning blend of texture and composition. The Grand Prix of frog jumping, sponsored by a fine French restaurant. A
A stand-in accepts the award for the late champion, Le Grand Charles. The great advantage of a fraternity, says the president of Phi Delta, is that when we leave class, we have good, clean fun. Not like those weirdos in the dean's office. And besides, it's for charity. The Salvation Army goes acid. Sally Ann and the electric tambourines turn on with good old time religion.
Well, everybody's heard about the bird.
At the Condor Club in San Francisco, Carol Doda starts a topless craze. Then she boosts her act with silicone injections from 35 to 44. But fame brings problems. When a man asks me out, she complains, I never know if he's interested in me or them. In the last of the blood sports, the Louisville Lif is moving up.
See, I've had 180 amateur fights, World Olympic gold medal winner and role medalist, two-time United States Golden Glove champion, two-time United States AAU champion, Pan American champion, Diamond Belt champion, a world second ranking heavyweight, and I'm as pretty as you, and you're not a fighter.
The champion is Sonny Liston. To Cassius, he's just a big, ugly bear. Liston says he's afraid of only one thing, that he'll need a doctor to get his fist out of the mouth of clay. The gamblers agree it's 8-1 against the Lip, but he keeps on spouting.
So when the gong rings and the referee sings out, the winner, and Sonny Liston will fall, Cassius Clay will be the noblest Roman of them all.
The bat couldn't hurt me.
Exactly.
The bat couldn't even get a good look at the hospital. Put him in the hospital. He's never been stopped. He's never been rocked. Oh, I'm so great. Oh, I'm so great. Oh, I shook up. And what makes it so good, all these hypocrites, you can't call it a fix. You can't call it a fix because I didn't stop the fight. The doctors had to stop it. Oh, I'm so pretty. I shook up the world.
For the amateurs, it's an Olympic year. At the Winter Games in Innsbruck, the full-time amateurs from Russia clean up. The USSR takes the gold medal in hockey, and 10 more. No other country can come up with more than 4. Two men die in practice on the ice-coated bobsled course. The four-man team from Canada provides one of the major upsets of the games. They walk away with a gold medal and all bones intact. At the Summer Games in Tokyo, the United States evens the score with the Russians. Bob Hayes wins one of 36 golds and the title of the world's fastest human. Soccer in Peru is a passion, a dangerous passion. When the score is 1-1, the referee disallows a home side goal, and 50,000 fans begin to pour onto the field. They panic. Hundreds are trampled at the gates, and the mob goes on to loot and burn in the streets. The death toll is 293. A fisherman who lost his family of five says, people came at us like waves in a bad sea. The Constitution is suspended. There's a week of national mourning. Peru's foremost historian talks of the poor of his country. They've lost hope, he says. And when this happens, people sometimes behave more like brutes than men. In Panama, too, the troops have to be called out. Through the middle of the country runs a strip of American soil. It's called the Canal Zone. Panama threatens to take over the zone. President Johnson considers sending in the Marines. Instead, he negotiates a new treaty. He reaps praise from all sides for a peaceful foreign policy. Eighteen miles under Alaska on that fateful Good Friday, two rock masses in the Earth's interior slip against one another. They bring on a quake with the force of 200,000 megatons, the strongest ever to hit North America. When the ground stops shaking, it's split apart, and a tidal wave sweeps across the Pacific at 500 miles an hour. The dollar damage is estimated at $350 million. Schools are cut in two. Homes swallowed whole, downtowns wrecked, and 117 die. The Kennedy luck lets the Kennedys down again. Teddy Kennedy, campaigning for a Senate seat from Massachusetts, breaks his back in a plane crash. Once more, the family gathers around, this time to comfort, not to mourn. Flat on his stomach in hospital, Teddy keeps the drive alive. His back may be broken, but he wins his seat hands down. Greatest show on earth, and the most expensive. It's long on bombast and short on suspense. The Democrats already have a president. They gather at Atlantic City to act out their parts in a television spectacular directed by Lyndon himself. The only spontaneous moment comes when they pause to honor the memory of John F. Kennedy.
And now, it is my privilege and honor to introduce the man who stood closer to him in times of crisis and in times of fun than anyone else, his brother, Robert Kennedy.
For 22 long minutes, while his wife watches, the delegates pour out their affection for Bobby and for the man who was their president.
Mr. Chairman, I realize that as an individual, that we can't just look back, that we must look forward. When I think of President Kennedy, I think of what Shakespeare said in Romeo and Juliet, when he shall die, take him and cut him out in little stars, and he shall make the face of heaven so fine that all the world will be in love with night and pay no worship to the garish sun. But I realize, as an individual, and really...
Lyndon has refused him the vice presidency, but Bobby remains loyal to the party.
I realize that as an individual, and even more importantly, for a political party and for the country, that we can't just look to the past, but we must look to the future. And so I join with you in realizing that if what has been started 4 years ago, that everyone here started 4 years ago, if that's to be sustained, if that's to be continued, the same effort and the same energy and the same dedication, It was given to President John F. Kennedy. Must be given to President Lyndon Johnson and Hubert Humphrey.
It takes a pro to make these gestures of support. And that's what Bobby is, and that's what Bobby does. Barry Goldwater has had the Republican nomination sewn up for months. He appeals to a pioneer America, a Puritan America, before such things as sex and taxes. America the brave, America the good.
I accept your nomination with humbleness, with pride, and you and I are going to fight for the goodness of our land. Thank you.
Inside the hall, everyone's for Barry, but he has split his party right down the middle. Republicans either love him or they hate him so much they'll vote Democrat. The man from the West shoots straight from the hip.
We are asking for World War III with the kind of policies that we're following around the world today, and yet we have Americans who believe that we can live with a godless enemy.
And whether we like it or not, if we're going to live in peace in the Western Hemisphere, someday, and the sooner the cheaper, and the sooner the better, communism has to get out of Cuba.
I am called a warmonger for speaking like this, and I suggest that I am a peacemonger when I talk like this.
I would remind you that extremism in the defense of liberty is no vice.
Out of the deep South struts a jaunty new contender. They laughed when George Wallace sat down in the primaries. They didn't laugh when his votes were counted. He shows solid support outside the South. Wallace seems a natural for Goldwater's running mate.
Would you run for second place as vice president with Barry Goldwater? Would you support him for president against Lyndon Johnson?
I don't know why y'all are laughing when they say, will I run for vice president, but what does a Goldwater victory mean to you? Well, it means he won in California. I asked Senator Goldwater, will he run with me? His vice, but I'm running. I haven't decided who I'll have for my vice presidential candidate yet. But no use of me talking about supporting anyone else while I'm running. I'm a candidate.
Lyndon Johnson preaches peace, unity, and love. Texas style. Hands raw from grabbing and shaking, he plunges into every waiting crowd. Y'all come and hear the speaking, he commands. Come on down to hear the speaking. When not orating about the Great Society, Big Daddy has his birds campaign. First, there's Lady Bird.
I've heard it said, and I agree, that the South is not a matter of geography, but a place of the heart. And Georgia is not only a state, it is a distinctive part of America. America grows up smacking its lips over Georgia broiler chicken and Georgia peanut butter, drinking Coca-Cola, and I certainly don't want to leave out Towny Town.
Then there's Linda Bird.
As I came in, a little boy said, well, wait, you know, stuck his hand out, and I felt kind of bad about having to hurry and get up here, but Daddy says I'm always late anyway. And so I thought maybe for once I better try to be on time, but I hope I will be able to shake hands with everybody, or at least a fair size of you, and meet you when Daddy finishes speaking. Thank you.
For those who like a different brand of humor, the Democrats try to sink Barry with his own speeches.
In a Saturday Evening Post article dated August 31st, 1963, Barry Goldwater said, sometimes I think this country would be better off if we could just saw off the eastern seaboard and let it float out to sea. Can a man who makes statements like this be expected to serve all the people justly and fairly?
I
understand, however, that while he was here, that he came up with a solution for crime in Central Park. He would use conventional nuclear weapons and defoliate it.
The man's done a lot. He's used to that spot. So tell me why not vote for Lyndon.
Steve Lawrence and Edie Gourmet are for Lyndon. He's got the show business vote and just about everybody else.
Yes, we know where we're going. America's really on the way. The victory vote is for LBJ.
We want Lyndon. We want Lyndon. We want Lyndon.
They want Lyndon. They get Lyndon. When he goes home to Texas on election eve, there is no doubt about the outcome. The only question is by how much. A long year after the tragedy in Dallas, Lyndon Johnson has emerged from the shadow of John Kennedy.
Thank you. Beyond that, I want to add only that it seems to me tonight, here in Austin, the great capital of this great state, that I have spent my life getting ready for this moment. And so have we all. The rest is only dedication.
The victory is overwhelming. The president's popularity is enormous. How will he shape the great society he speaks of? Along with Carol Channing, the nation croons, "Hello, Lyndon." How will it say goodbye?